Hello, my friend Steven, are you there? There you are.
You look great. You must be on TV today.
No.
Oh, it's being recorded. What's going on?
No. I think you know what it must be because you're the second person to say that. All I did was I put a bobby pin because my side of my hair was poofing out, and I stuck a bobby pin there. But I must do that with my hair more often because you're the second person to say that to me today.
Like a glam look.
Really? It's only a bobby pin. Like I just twirled it. One of my aunts always does that with her hair, and I thought, well, we got kind of similar features. Maybe that'll work on me too. So
So I put a shirt on today, rather than
you
my
decided to get dressed.
Jerome says that's the third time you've worn this shirt this week because I wore it for the executive board. So
Oh,
don't
that's
tell anyone. It's going in the wash tomorrow.
yeah.
It's a birthday shirt. I'm trying to figure out. I want to get the French in the sign so it doesn't look like we're completely Anglo.
Oh, on our captioning. Hold on here.
Do that. On the display behind me. See
Oh, I
behind
see.
me.
Okay. And I'm only because we don't have any French participants, from what I understand. So I'm gonna just
And I
do.
think there's one Francophone that I see in the list.
Did they request French? Because
No.
my worry is I don't think I can show both of those documents at the same time.
And that's fine. That's totally fine.
Okay.
I was just talking about the display behind me. You're supposed to be impressed.
Oh yes, I'm sorry. Let me take a moment. And I did take that in, and I was like, okay, he's got that. The one thing, my one request would be if we can get rid of the chandelier in the shot a little bit.
Chandelier. That would be this.
No, up above the other side, up on the ceiling.
Oh
Can we
yeah.
just turn the camera slightly?
Oh, it's supposed to provide light. Let me
Oh,
see.
okay. Well, if it works, don't. It's not a big deal.
Is
Oh no,
that?
I like the light. I like the light. I was just wondering if you could turn your screen just slightly, just so that it isn't, because it makes you unbalanced.
Oh, I so want to be balanced. You should have worked with me on the Mayworks Festival because I'm all about production qualities. Well, you know
Stephen,
that.
I'll work on it with you on anything you ever want. Don't worry about that.
You're so good at helping with the beginning of the meeting. It's sort of like break a leg.
Yeah. Sorry, Stephen, I just want to knock off a few things before people come on.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to figure out how to get the French. I thought it did an automatic French translation. Maybe I'm mistaken.
No one asked for it.
No.
Under
So
live transcript, is it there?
I guess we're doing auto transcript. Okay, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I just got it in my own head that there was some sort of French translation, but I guess.
Yeah, no, like the capacity is there, but we don't need it.
Maybe we actually would have had to have hired somebody to do that if that's what I'd want. Okay, so maybe I'm mistaken. I'm just misremembering things. Okay, give me one second before I let people in. I just want to make sure I can do my save screen. I was having problems with my camera this morning, so I had to reload all the pictures in. So let me just go to that, make sure I can do it quickly enough. So we've got, I just want to close some of these things down. So I don't get confused. Bear with me a second.
Join me
This
if
can close. Okay, so if I want to go to share screen.
you.
Can't tell just by looking at these. I've got too many things open here. Let me close some of this down.
Is this
Close,
the statement
close,
you want?
close, close. Okay. Okay, I'm kind of freaking out. I can't see the quality statement here.
Okay, take your time. Maybe let people in and you
But I
can.
can see it on my computer, but it's not coming up. I can see the draft agenda. Okay, hold on. I'm gonna go over here and just save these, and then maybe that'll help.
I used to have a hard copy, but I
No,
looked.
I've got it. I have it up here. I can see it in the PDF, but it's not showing up on my screen when I go to screen, share screen. Let me just save this on my desktop and see if that'll help.
Maybe Darius
Save.
can help.
No.
No.
He's doing other stuff right now.
Oh
And let me go to back to that. Save as.
my God. Go to
Here.
the left.
Save as. Okay. And let's go here. Let's close this. Let's go to share screen. And I'm going to go to.
Well, you know what, Megan? Can you
Yeah.
let people in? Because I am
Okay.
going to join me and you can keep working on it.
I'm afraid I'm going to be a little slower than I wanted to be on this, though.
That's all
Okay, I
right.
can search them, I think, and add them. Okay. Okay, I'm going to come back and I'm going to share it. View.
You have to let people in while you're doing
Yep. We've already got some people on the line now.
that. Okay, I wanted to say hello. Hi. Who's there?
Today, my name is Brian Shimla. I'm from QP101, or we used to be QP101, London.
Great. What are you now, Brian? Oh, look at that.
Retiree.
Yeah. Okay. 101. There's Joanne. Hi, Joanne. There's Janet.
Henry here from Hamilton to be 7800 retiree.
Yeah, okay. Doug.
How do I get rid of the transcription?
I think at the bottom
You
of your
just you
screen.
go X on
Okay.
the right hand, but
If you see at the
if
bottom
you
of the screen,
find
it
it
says
there.
CC live transcript.
No, I don't have bottom. It's a, what do you call it, iPad.
Okay, so
There's nothing on the bottom.
do you have a section, Joanne, that says more dot dot dot?
Yes.
Okay, click on that.
Yes.
And then does it give you an option for live transcript?
View full transcript. Meeting settings.
What else? Is that
Meeting
it?
settings, minimize meeting and background and filters.
That doesn't sound like an option that would work. I'm not sure what it looks like. I know what it looks like on the desktop, but I'm not sure on the iPad.
And you can see us, right?
Oh yeah, I can see everything fine. I just don't like the writing on the bottom because then I can only see half of you.
Oh, well, we want to be
But your
completely
blessings,
seen.
Joanne.
Yeah, that's true.
Hello, everybody.
Ori.
Honey. How do I get my
Sebastian.
camera to work?
Turn it on.
Where?
At the
Do
bottom
you
left, you'll see where it says there's a
video?
camera with a line through it. Click on that.
And Doug Jones?
Hi, Doug.
Hi.
Hi, Philip.
I'm not getting a picture of me.
Philip with the bicycle. Hi.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Bertha.
Hey, Dennis. Philip.
Hi. They're all looking at different people.
Hi, Dennis. He looks too young.
Philip, you look too young to be a retiree. But Philip, you're welcome to. We're happy to have you on now. But I think we fumble our way through just getting everybody set up for a couple of minutes. So if you don't have to present or anything just yet.
When would you like me to potentially come back?
Keep your video on. We want to watch the bicycle.
Let me just check something, Philip.
Henri. Hello. Working on the connection. Aaron, hello.
Hi. Still trying to get my picture up there.
Bonjour, comment ça va, Henri?
Oui, ça va très bien, merci.
Okay. Susan, hello from Niagara? St. Catharines?
Hi, everybody.
You are in St. Catharines, hello. Right?
No, technically, I'm in Welland.
Okay, we'll accept that. Bertha, hello. Ryan, Joanne.
Hello, hello. Bonjour, Annie.
Richard, good to see you. Bonjour. Abdullah, hello. Kate is connecting.
Hello.
I am there.
Hello, everybody.
Irene, is that you on the telephone?
Steven, I'm sorry, I can't see the agenda right here. Philip is on the line. He joined us a little bit earlier, and I can't remember what time we said yesterday that we needed him to come on.
So we said it's right here, at 2:10. I'm just moving the agenda. Two fifteen.
Because he's got lots to work on. So if we can free him up to go work on that, then can you come back a little bit before 2:15, just in case we're ahead of time?
Sounds good. I'll see you folks in a little over an hour.
Awesome. See you then.
Right. Take care.
Bye.
Okay. See you then. Who's on the telephone? It could be Irene.
Lots of folks still joining.
Hey, Vern.
Hi.
Yeah, hello. So we have 43 people on our list. Trying to put on the gallery view. Oh, that's better. Now I can see you all. Hi, Beth. Beth, say hello. Okay, Dan. Megan, can you bring up
the equality statement?
Yeah. While we're waiting for people. So again, this is the QP Ontario equality statement. It's read at the beginning of each meeting by decision of our convention. Can you enlarge it on your screen a little bit? On your computer? That's in place, you know.
I would be happy to, Stephen, if I could figure out where I was doing that.
Just on your computer at the bottom, you can enlarge it. And it's a Word document, right?
Yeah. And is that better?
Perfect.
Okay.
I'm going to start off and then we'll welcome people in a few minutes. Union solidarity is based on the principle that union members are equal and deserve mutual respect at all levels. Any behavior that creates conflict prevents us from working together to strengthen our union. As unionists, mutual respect and cooperation and understanding are our goals. We should neither condone nor tolerate behavior that undermines the dignity or self-esteem of any individual or creates an intimidating, hostile, or offensive environment. Discriminatory speech or conduct, which is racist, sexist, homophobic, or transphobic, hurts and therefore divides us. So too, this discrimination on the basis of ability, age, class, religion, language, and ethnic origin. Sometimes discrimination takes the form of harassment. Harassment means using real or perceived power to abuse, devalue, or humiliate. Harassment should not be treated with reproach. Meanness and resentment that it creates are not feelings of the union. The discrimination and harassment actually focus on characteristics that make us different, and they reduce our capacity to work together on shared concerns, such as decent wages, safe working conditions, justice in the workplace, society, and our union, and retiree coordination and mobilization. You can see those words there, right? QP policies and practices must reflect our commitment to equality. Members, staff, elected officers, and retirees must be mindful that all persons deserve dignity, equality, and respect. And you see at the bottom, Fred Hahn's name, our press, stand by, he's joining us any minute, and Candace Rennick, who's our our Ontario Secretary Treasurer. I jumped the gun there. So, next on our agenda, and you will have seen it, is the we have three statements. So we have a land acknowledgement that Joanne Webb is going to read. Joanne and I were on several union boards together, right, Joanne? Joanne was the head, the previous head, chair, I guess, of the Indigenous Council of QP Ontario. And she's an amazing, fabulous person. That's your introduction, Joanne. And any second, the land acknowledgement will go up so we can all read it. Meanwhile, do you want to just introduce your introduction?
Omagaanagoknadisnakaz, Hamilton Ndojaba, Mississauga Nada. My traditional name is Leader of Stars. You know your GST name, which is Joanne Webb. I live in Hamilton and my nation is Mississauga.
Can I just check, are you able to see the Indigenous greeting?
I have a copy in front of me.
Okay.
You can do up the next one.
Yeah. So,
it's not up, by the way.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So Joanne, you're on, go ahead.
Okay, there we go.
There we go.
As we come together from our homes and workplaces and our union offices all across the province, I would like to acknowledge that I am here today on the traditional and treaty territories of the Mississauga of the Credit. So welcome to my territory. That's also the homeland of the Haudenosaunee. So this is the Hamilton area. And in particular, I'd like to acknowledge our peoples whose ancestral lands I am connecting to virtually. So I also acknowledge that you are joining us from many territories across this Turtle Island, and I have inhabited, which have been inhabited by Indigenous peoples from the beginning of time. We are honored to be here as our guests. I'm using the word we literally, on this land that Indigenous peoples have cared for many years and continue to care for. We invite you to take a moment of yourselves to locate your where you presently live and honor the people of that land. Please feel free to type in the chat while you are joining us, where you are joining us from. Think of your relation to the place you live, work, and interact. We are also compelled to acknowledge our colonists' history, the devastation and destruction it has caused, and the ways it continues to damage the life of so many Indigenous people. We continue to commit ourselves to working with others to bring justice to murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls from coast to coast. Especially with the recent finding of the recovery of the Indigenous children buried in unmarked mass graves on the sites of former residential school across the country. As we've been telling them all along, we are reminded of the haunting and horrific legacy of the residential school systems and the ongoing harm Canada's, I can't say that word, politics and colonial laws have on Indigenous people. We are all witness to the deep disparities of our communities, and we are committed to working dignifiedly to achieve prosperity and equality for all peoples. Our recognition of the historic performance of Indigenous people is clearly and overtly linked to our collective commitment to make the promise and the challenge of truth and reconciliation real in our communities and our nations. Miigwech, and thank you, and sorry for the mistakes.
I just want to say, I just tried in my head to say it, assimilationist, I think it's a word. It's a mouthful.
You gotta dumb it down for me if you want me to do it.
Yeah, well, I just stumbled across it. I was like, what is that word?
How do you say it?
I think it's assimilationist policies. I mean, it's not a word I've used.
Yeah. So, okay, thank you. Miigwech.
Miigwech.
I've got to say, adding the little piece on the children got to me a little bit, even reading it for the first time. And I want to thank whoever did that thank them very much. And it's very welcome to hear. And I will actually be passing this opening on to other people. Miigwech, thank you.
Could you name your local, you're an honorary member of one local of QP?
I'm really from 7800, but I'm an honorary member of 5167.
You just received, now I'm like, she told me already, you just received some kind of award. Like, what was that?
Well, my nation, Mississaugas, have started last year a Trailblazer Awards, and two of them are for volunteering, and two of them are for basically going out into the community and telling people about our nation and talking about the history of our nation and working along with all different groups. And so because of my activism in the union and now my volunteer work in the city, they gave me the second, it was the second year that it was offered, and I was awarded it. It was very nice to have a nice family dinner, even though it was outside, everything was outside. It was nice to be able to get together for the first time in a long time, because we haven't had powwows in 2 years, and they haven't done, they've done a lot of research, but they haven't done a lot of meeting, that's for sure, except virtually, of course. But I was very proud, very honored to have been awarded that award. Miigwech, thank you for...
So, thank you. On behalf of all of us, Doug Jones proposed a minute of silence. So I think that's really appropriate after what we've had. And if we can add to that, those retirees who since our last meeting have died, some of them in long-term care facilities. So if that would be all right with everyone, we'll just have a minute of silence. Thanks very much, everyone. I'm going to welcome Suki Gepka, who I've volunteered to read the third statement that is provided at the start of every meeting at QP Ontario, which is a recognition of the decade of people of African descent, which is a UN decade. Do you have it with you by any chance, Susan?
Can I check? Can you see it on the screen? To me, it's saying no. It's sharing.
You have to click it to get it on the screen. And no, you said you'd have these statements up. So I'm just waiting for it to come on the screen.
Okay, I'm going to stop share and I'll redo it.
Oh, I don't know why my profile's working off, but okay.
But Susan, what local are you from?
Just waiting for it to come up.
Can you see it now?
There's something wrong. Can others see it?
No.
I think it's on my end, Susan, because it's showing as it's sharing, but it doesn't seem to be. I'm going to do it again.
Meanwhile, Susan, can you just indicate what QP local you're
No, at? Still the same.
Okay, we'll wait for it.
Now what's happening? I'm just trying to focus on seeing the screen. There it is.
Yeah. Stephen, I did the same thing. I just did it three times.
Sorry, Stephen. I got to focus on the task at hand. And you know I've done this before, though. But you know what, sibling? You're still terrific, fabulous, and amazing. I'm Susan Gapka. I've been asked to read this statement. I use she, her pronouns. Elle français, s'il vous plaît. I am on the executive committee as a chair of Pink Triangle Committee, and I'm really blessed and honored to play that role. And I'm with QP Local 2998, but it's in my profile description under beside my name, which is the Association of Community Centers in Toronto, downtown Toronto, mostly downtown Toronto. So let me see if I can get this screen. I'm going to read the statement of recognition of UN International Decade for People of African Descent. And thank you for the honor of asking me to read this. QP Ontario recognizes the UN Declaration. Let me do that again. UN International Decade for People of African Descent. In 2013, the General Assembly of the United Nations declared January 1st, 2015 until December 31st, 2024 as the International Decade for People of African Descent. The theme of the decade is People of African Descent, Recognition, Justice, and Development. And get the screen to go up a little bit. Thank you very much. Given the existence of slavery in Canada from the 16th century to 1834 and ongoing inequalities and injustices towards people of African descent, QP Ontario acknowledges the importance of this decade. This decade is an opportunity to celebrate and recognize the important contributions made by people of African descent to our union and society and to work towards reparations and justice. Following consultations, a United Nations working group of experts drafted a clear list of recommendations to address structural barriers faced by people of African descent across Canada. These recommendations can guide us in our work as activists. As a progressive labor union, we have a responsibility to act. The anti-racism organizational action plan, otherwise known as AROP, is one way we can continue to do better. As a union, we can concentrate, we can take concrete measures to ensure the full inclusion of people of African descent. We can work to combat anti-Black racism, racial discrimination, xenophobia, and other forms of oppression. No one is free until we are all free. And thank you.
Thank you, Susan, on all our behalf. And welcome to everyone who has joined us during the reading of the statement at the beginning of the meeting. According to my screen, it looks like there are 50 people with us, but there are fewer. We had 41 registered. So welcome. And I will be calling on you to approve the agenda, which Megan's put up on the screen. And then I'll be fishing for little examples of retiree activism in your local union. So that's coming up. And here it is. Agenda with photographs, never come. I'm going to, well, this is very good. First, we've done the first part without approving the agenda. That's all right.
Stephen, I can hardly hear you, hon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Really? Okay, is that better?
Way better.
Usually yeah. We have no trouble hearing you, Stephen. What's up?
Okay.
That's much better. Thank you.
By the opening. So here's the agenda, which we'll review and have a motion to approve. Just, first of all, Fred Hahn, you see his picture there. We'll begin with who's here today. I'll be doing shout outs if you're from locals, district councils, or you just happen to drop by. And then we'll be looking after Fred talks, we chat with him and ask him questions and he answers better. We'll be just doing a bit of retiree news around the province. So for the locals, you see a picture of Mike there on the right in 2316. District councils, there's Ed Thomas, and the Ontario Executive Board. So a few reports on that. I've actually, what's it called? Buttonholed a few people saying, would you like to, I'm going to call on you because you're in a local where something might or might not be happening. Then we're going to, Megan's going to introduce Philip, who's basically on the wall. I'm going to thank Megan for all the work that she's doing. And we're going to end with a quick discussion of the upcoming QP Ontario convention and who expects to be a delegate. And there you see on the side, some amazing people. Well, Joanne is the very most amazing person at the convention. So going back to this slide, can I have a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Might there be a seconder?
I'll second.
Great. So just so you know, we're not taking minutes as such, but this is being recorded, so watch your language. But that will be our at the meeting. So discussion on the agenda, additions, for example.
Stephen? Yeah, sorry, it's a little hard here. I think I've finally got the setting up here. So sorry to barge in without putting my hand up. So I talked to you just previously about a couple amendments to the agenda.
Yes, and I've added them in and they'll be there. I put them on my little cheat sheet here. And that has to do with the resolution going to national convention.
Yeah, and just to let you know, those will be, I think, did you say Candace was coming online?
No, just Fred.
Okay, because they would be, just to say what those items are quickly, and then we'll get to it on the agenda around an endorsement for Candace Rennick, who's running for National Secretary Treasurer, and you might have heard, and also just to work in there around the diversity vice president's resolution. So I'll park that for now. And thank you, Stephen, for including those quick amendments that I thought of just this morning.
Okay, that's how we roll, Susan and I. Further amendments to the agenda? Hearing none, all those in favor of the agenda?
Aye.
Wave, whatever. Those opposed? Okay, those are remaining hands. I think it was that we have an agenda that was approved unanimously. And here goes. Welcome to those people who arrived while we were in the middle of that item. Great to have you here. I want to say that we're waiting for Fred Hahn to come on. This was all time to the second.
Can here? I just check something here? I see that Joanne Johnson has her hand up. Did you want to say something? Or is that an old hand?
We all got old hands.
We're all old hands. Joanne, just jump in if you do have something. Megan, have you seen Fred Hahn?
I'm just texted him just to give him a nudge. Sometimes, you know, his schedule is so busy. Sometimes he has to just kind of jump in, or he gets held up on a call. So,
okay, I have something up my sleeve. If everyone turns their mic off and it's like silent as possible, I'm just going to go through. Ed, who are you?
Ed Thomas, local 5167 Hamilton.
Good. We're going to come back to you. Let's see, who has their microphone? Richard, who are you?
Richard DiGaetano, QP 1777 at Social Planning Toronto.
Great. I'm going to ask other people to take their mics off rather than waiting for me to ask you. Vern.
Vern Andrews, QP Local 5555.
And
I think somebody's talking over you.
Yeah. And there we go. Okay. While we're waiting for Fred, I'm going to continue. Thanks, Ed and Vern and Richard. Henri.
To do, and I'm not sure that Putin is actually organized this way.
Can we? There we go.
I'll go. Stephen?
Okay, go. I think you already introduced yourself.
I did. I just say I'm someone who's had a senior moment this morning, and I'll be a retiree shortly, so I'm mostly here to support Megan and Stephen and try to keep, you know, we try to leave no one behind. And so here to help with that.
Great. We're all heading to retirement. So Ari, do you want to just say what local you're from, where you're located?
Ari or Henry? there's two of us here, French and English. And me, I'm from local 146.
Sorry, guys. I'm going to back
up. Can you mute us? Yeah.
Yeah. I think it just keeps getting unmuted.
Dennis, who are you?
Retired from 3906. Very interested in QP climate justice policy.
Martin. Okay, Mike
Deneen, 2316, Children's Aid Society. What else? That's it for now.
That's good. Bev Desjardins.
Hello.
You need to unmute yourself.
Okay, now it's working. Hi, I'm Bev from Local 2599 in Sudbury Developmental Services.
Great, thank you. And Bavaria? I'm going to ask everyone to have their finger on the button that is on the unmute button. Okay, Amar.
Yeah, I'm Amar Bajwa, president of QP Local 2191. Not retired yet, probably another year and a half or so. So DSW sector, and we also, I'm just here to know a little bit more about how we can amend the bylaws to reflect the retirees committee in my bylaws. Thank you.
What's the workplace, Amar? You said it in very quickly.
Sorry?
Your workplace.
Oh, workplace. Community live in Toronto? Development okay. Service sector.
I'm just letting Fred into the room.
So, Amara, that's Local 2191. And there's another member of 2191 about to walk into the room.
Yes, Andrew Beecher is a treasurer local, yes.
Okay. Fred Hahn, what local are you from?
Hello.
Hi there. I'm from Local 2191. I'm from QP Ontario. How are you all? Nice to see you all.
Hi, Fred. Loving you.
Fred Amar just introduced himself as a member of your local. That's why I jumped to
Hi, Fred.
Hey, Amar.
Yes. Hello there, man. How are you?
Like, look at both screens, one and two, or maybe you have a big computer screen and you'll see how many of us are here. There are 43 registered, including you, just to say. I don't want you to get stage fright or anything, Fred, but I'm just going to say that you're now up on the agenda. I'm going to first ask people to raise their hands or shout out if you're a participant today.
I couldn't hear what you said there, Steve.
Okay. If you are a retiree representing a local or from a local, please raise your hand. That would be me. Okay, hands down. So that gives us some idea. If you're on a QP district council as a retiree rep, please put up your hand. Well, that's a couple of us. Bavoria has her hand up, I think, yeah.
Yes, I did.
Great. Bavoria, what local are you from?
79.
And you are 79's representative to the which district council?
Toronto District Council.
Great. Okay. Anyone else from a district council in the room? Okay, I thought you
were. I'm from a labor council.
Okay, that qualifies. Ed, the author, thank you very much. So that's who's in the room. All those people, raise your hand if you are about to retire or you wish you were already retired. So there's Susan, and there's a few of us. Well, a few of you.
If I may say, Stephen, this whole thing about retiree is a myth.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Raise your hand if you agree with that comment. Okay, so next on the agenda, I think you've seen it, Fred, who knows, it's a chat with Fred. And I'm hoping Fred
chat with us. Sorry, Stephen, your sound is a little, keeps going in and out a bit.
Yep.
Okay. Let me try again. Fred, this is a chat. what's up with what are you doing? What's up with QP Ontario? What would you like to share with us? You have 10 or 15 minutes, I don't know, something like that.
Well, I will do my best to not, once you get me going, you got to let me go usually, right? So I'll try to be concise. First of all, I want to just say how great it is to see some, like all of you, even if it's, you know, in boxes on Zoom. It is a great, great thing that that folks are together. I just came from a discussion about a piece of legislation introduced by the Ford Conservative government called the Working for Workers Act. It is a cynical and craven attempt to try to pretend that the Conservatives have changed their stripes. We know, or their spots, as they say, a leopard doesn't change their spots. The legislation purports to do a bunch of really good things. You might have heard a bunch of media coverage, for example, that it will require employers to allow workers to unplug from work so that they're not in this virtual world working 24/7. In fact, what the legislation says is we're going to require employers to write a policy. It doesn't say what that policy has to say. And it's quite likely that employers will simply, you know, as all of us might do, be reminded that we have this thing called the Employment Standards Act in the province, and we have collective agreements and people already have overtime. This is it is fluff. It means nothing. There are jurisdictions in the world that actually have real laws that protect workers in this way. That is not what this is, but they're getting credit for it. Like, that's what this is. There's also access for people who are delivery people so that they can use washrooms at the places they're dropping food. I mean, all, you know, fine. But when we talk about working for workers, we all know, you all know on this call, that the kinds of things we've been advocating for generations, paid sick time in legislation, the temporary workers who are filling in for others should be paid the exact same rate of pay, that there should be card check certification, it should be easier to join a union. There are many things about which we would say working for workers looks like. The other thing that's quite startling about this legislation is that it takes surpluses at the Workplace Safety and Insurance Board and returns them to employers. It's estimated that the surplus at the Workplace Safety and Insurance Board is about $3 billion. $3 billion with a B. And that money's gonna go back to employers. Employers who, over the last 6 years, five times over the last 6 years, premiums have been decreased for employers. In fact, benefits for injured workers have been cut as well, because there was this huge unfunded liability at the Workplace Safety and Insurance Board. And in fact, now that there is a surplus on the backs of injured workers, I might add, that money isn't going back to injured workers, isn't going to restore cuts made to benefits for injured workers, isn't going to actually deal with the massive backlog of WSIB cases that the pandemic has caused, particularly around mental health and post-traumatic stress. There's a huge number of workers who have applied sitting, waiting in limbo to have these cases dealt with. No, in fact, that money is going to go back to employers. So this piece of legislation, Working for Workers, is just another fine example of how the Conservatives are who the Conservatives are, but they are in high campaign mode. They are trying very hard to convince you and me and our members and our neighbors and our friends that they deserve to be reelected. They're doing it in a whole bunch of different ways, not just this Working for Workers Act, but you might have heard that they also relented and agreed to raise the minimum wage as of January the 1st to $15 an hour. Of course, it is important to know, remember, that it was the Conservatives who cut the minimum wage increase that was scheduled to go to $15 an hour more than 3 years ago when they were first elected. conservatives like to talk about, we're going to put money in your pockets. What they did was take over $5,000 out of the lowest paid workers' pockets by stopping that minimum wage increase. They're simply relenting now as a PR measure. It's also important to note, because of the rising costs of everything, which I'm sure you all know, because we all see it at the grocery store, at the gas pump, anywhere, we see that inflation is back. The Living Wage Network published a study, helpfully, just a few weeks ago, which pointed out that $15 an hour is not a living wage anywhere in the province of Ontario. In fact, the least expensive place to live, Sault Ste. Marie, you still need to make over 16 bucks an hour just to have a living wage. And in a place like Toronto or Hamilton or some of these larger cities, we're up to 22, 23 bucks an hour. So all of that to say, really, you know, there's so much we could talk about. It's been so challenging for our members in our workplaces now for 20 months. You know, we had everything happen at the beginning of the pandemic. So many people were laid off. People were working without proper PPE, and no one knew what it was we were facing. Then things, you know, kind of started to stabilize, and yet we still saw huge, particularly in long-term care, but in parts of healthcare, huge impacts for seniors and patients, but also for workers. We're now in a circumstance where, you know, this deeply divisive process has infiltrated our local unions around this question of vaccination policies. And I hope you will have seen what our union's been saying primarily about this is that, in fact, look, these policies are not ours. They are those of government. What we are saying is that we know, based on all of the evidence and information available to all of us, that vaccines are safe and effective, and everybody who can be vaccinated should be vaccinated. But we're also in a circumstance where we have the potential for members, people who worked hard during this pandemic, who went to work every day, some of whom who lived in their garages because they were so uncertain about and so worried about impacting or infecting their families potentially, that we now have the potential for some of those workers to be terminated from their employment is a step too far in our view. And so we're doing our best to defend those workers as well. It's a very, 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 very challenging time. And just to put everything on top of it, we're already in election season. As you might've seen online and on television, ads by the Conservatives. Hopefully you've seen some ads from the NDP as well. Talking about the provincial election already, and we're seeing these kinds of pieces of legislation like this Working for Workers bill and their moves on minimum wage, because they're in high campaign mode. They know that the people of Ontario are pretty mad and should be mad about the way they handled this pandemic and about the cuts they made prior to it, right? But it's important for us to be reminded that just last week, in the economic statement released from the government, their sort of mini budget, they couldn't resist cutting $500 million more dollars from our schools in the midst of a pandemic. And one of our real challenges is that not much of this gets talked about in the media, and that not much of this, when people are still so clearly focused on just getting by, going to work, raising their kids, trying to figure stuff out. One of our challenges, and one of the things I hope I know we'll be able to count on all of you to do, is to actually, you know, remind folks of what has happened and talk about what is coming for all of us in terms of that provincial election. There's no doubt in my mind, I would hazard a guess to say that there's no doubt in any of yours, that this is not just a question of Doug Ford. Yes, Doug Ford should not be premier, but it's not just him. Every last Conservative MEP sitting in that legislature is responsible. Responsible mm-hmm. for their lack of action, responsible for the death of more than 4,000 seniors in long-term care because of their failures to act, responsible for the fact that they are secretly extending licenses to for-profit facilities as they come up to expire, meanwhile saying there would be consequences. Remember, you know, the crocodile tears when the military ran screaming from long-term care facilities, the crocodile tears and promises of the premier that these people would pay. In fact, they passed a law making it illegal for us to sue them. They protected them, didn't make them pay. And they're now extending licenses to them. These are the kinds of things that we're gonna do our best to make sure people know more about, our members, all of you, because our challenge is kind of the same as it's always been, but it's more acute now. Our challenge is gonna be to kind of move beyond the baffling bullshit, sorry for my terrible language, that we're gonna hear from them and actually talk truth to folks so that we can remember when it comes time for an election that how we mark our ballot matters, and that none of them, not a one of them, deserves to be reelected. Alongside that, there's a bunch of things that we're doing, and I wanna just quickly share with you one of the things. I know I've been talking for a while, and I'm gonna count on Stephen to cut me off because Lord knows I've done it to him, so he can do it to me. I wanna talk to you about the solidarity we're engaged in with our members in New Brunswick. And I wanna talk to you about that circumstance really briefly. In New Brunswick, our members across different sectors entered into a solidarity pact with one another about 4 or 5 years ago. And that solidarity pact meant that as collective agreements expired, they, when they got to sort of the impasse in bargaining, they didn't push. They didn't go to arbitration. They didn't push for a strike. They waited until every other collective agreement in the province opened as well. And they decided to work together to push the provincial government to a central table. Because while we have Bill 124 here, legislation that actually caps what public sector workers can bargain below the rate of inflation, they had a similar mandate there from the provincial government. And many workers had already taken years of zeros before this other mandate, which was, you know, they're the lowest paid public sector workers in all of Canada. You can make 10,000 bucks, you know, as a social worker, just going across the border to Nova Scotia from New Brunswick. Incredible amount of coordination and solidarity. Some collective agreements have been open for 5 years. Some have been open for 4. Some have been open for 3. They've been working together. Now all collective agreements for 22,000 workers are open just yesterday. We represent workers at the provincially run liquor stores. They've taken a strike vote and they will be joining picket lines as well. The base call for our members is real wages. And they are standing together, sticking together to achieve that. It is remarkable. And the government has done everything it can to muddle this, to try and communicate directly with workers, to try and cast doubt in our members' minds about whether or not a deal would have been possible that could have gotten them real wage increases, because they're also, of course, trying to go after pension concessions. You might remember, or you might not know, I'll just share with you that some QP members in New Brunswick got hooped into converting their pension from a defined benefit pension plan to a target benefit pension plan a number of years ago. And what the government's trying to do is force those remaining in a defined benefit pension plan to also convert. And our union is saying no. And that's one of the concessions they're standing up against, plus they're fighting for wages. I share this with you because it is remarkable. It basically is, in essence, a province-wide strike of QP members in the province of New Brunswick. Municipal workers, highway and roads workers, school board workers, some healthcare and hospital workers who actually can strike in New Brunswick and who were ordered back to work last week under a public health order. as I mentioned, liquor store workers. There's a lot of amazing things happening there. I want you to know that from QP Ontario's perspective, we have made several financial contributions to their central strike fund already. We have sent workers to their picket lines, including some of our Candace and Michael and some of the leaders, Laura, who leads our school board bargaining council. We sent the chair of our strike committee, Barry Conway. We sent one of our vice presidents, Brittany Nesbitt from Niagara. We're in close and constant contact with the leadership in New Brunswick. We're just about to launch campaigns with all of our locals and councils to encourage them to make donations to the Central Strike Fund, to send pictures and images of solidarity from our region. I mentioned this because it's incredibly inspiring, but it's also incredibly important because what happens in New Brunswick will absolutely matter here for us too. It is of course about those workers. It is of course about the struggle they're in. We're supporting them for that reason, but we're also clear that the organizing they have done to get to this place, to take on this particular conservative government in New Brunswick, and what happens with that will have real impacts here for all of us. Our hospitals are in central bargaining, facing concessions at the bargaining table and a refusal to deal with real wage increases. And they've been mobilizing and working with the SCIU in a pact here. Our school board members are just about to go into central bargaining or a central collective agreement in schools because the central agreement expires just before the election. There's much going on, and there's many ways for you all to plug in and to help out and to be involved and to be supportive. I am so grateful that you are, that we still have this connection with all of you because of your skill and your knowledge and your experience and your passion for our movement. It matters. And there's just a few challenges around, so we can use all the help we can get.
You said I should cut you off, and I couldn't think of a better time. I mean, maybe I could have thought of a better time, but Fred, that was so good. And thank you. Because I think what you've done is validate, is that a word? The reason we're all here. So on our behalf. That said, we have questions for you. And the floor is open for those questions. So put your hand up there, Richard. I was going to fill the space. Go ahead, Richard.
Always one of the first to ask the questions. Fred, I think it's great what we're doing in terms of supporting the New Brunswick workers. There are workers on strike all across North America who are fighting for the same kinds of things, equal rights and equal pay for equal work and safety and better conditions on the job. What are we doing from CUPE that's public? Because I haven't seen much in the way of public media statements or press media releases. Maybe they're on the website. I haven't been on the website. But, can you tell us a bit more of how we're going to get the word out to the rest of the working class in Ontario about some of these fights?
So Fred, I'm going to ask you to just, we're going to compile the questions. And that could be like a half hour answer, but whatever. Next question. Don't hold back.
See that Doug, can you see the hands that are up, Stephen?
Oh, okay.
Doug now Jones.
So Henry.
Sorry. Well, Doug was ahead of me.
Okay, Doug, you're on.
Fred, I have to admit, I liked your speech on CP24 about the $15 minimum wage. It hit the rock on the head. There's one thing I like to see is, unfortunately, our great premier, which I refused to be pictured with when he was a city councilor, and his brother cutting ground at Kipling Acres. They told me I had to be there. He says, sorry, you have to fire. I refuse to be with that guy. Says that we should not, we should be have solidarity and refuse the individual cities for the $10 minimum wage. My workplace, Kipling Acres, and I had Kipling Childcares. I worked at both places, and I saw those poor kids, single mothers, trying to make ends meet. And to be right now, it'd be nice to have all the unions that deal with childcare to say, hey, you cities are going to go to the federal government, say $10 minimum wage, we back you 100%. Thank you.
Thanks, Doug. Henry.
Yeah, hi, Fred. Great to see you again. And once again, you're doing a great job. Fred, a couple of things. I've been on the labor studies course at McMaster. And last night we were talking about just that thing, the basic wage and living wage. And I'm wondering, here in Hamilton, Labor Council, we're pushing the issue of living wage. And we think that all locals should be talking about living wage rather than basic wage or minimum wage. Basic wage does very little to lift workers out of poverty. And we're still seeing people who are on basic wage, you know, have the basic wage, having to do 2-3 jobs just to get by. So is CUPE going to be taking that stance as well, pushing for living wage rather than basic wage? Secondly, I posted this in the chat. I don't know if everybody's seen this or not, but Dean Allison, who's MP for Niagara West, has recently sponsored a petition. And this petition is calling for the government to approve ivermectin as a treatment for COVID. Now, I don't know if everybody remembers the foo-for-all that was out there because people were taking ivermectin in the States. It's been declared as a very dangerous drug for people to take. It's an antiparasitic and has not been proven to help COVID-19 at all. So I think we should be getting that message out to our members because this is an MP who's pushing for ivermectin. And I'm sure he knows that it's dangerous, but you know, of course, the drug companies are pushing for this as well because it means more money for them. So that's those are my questions.
Okay. So I'm going to do what we do for elections. Second call for questions. Third and final call for elections. Wave your hands. Fred, you're on.
Okay, I'm gonna try and make sure to get through this and some of the stuff that I saw in the chat too. How to get the word out and what are we doing? It is always a challenge, but it's been even more challenging during COVID. I really do wanna recognize some of our comms folks, Daniel Sagai, who we've been really lucky to have assigned to us, Philip Morgan, who does our social media stuff, because they have been, as you know, Doug mentioned, I was on CP24, it's been trying to get the word out has been really tough, but we have been making public statements. There are press releases. We are trying to use social media to get those out there. You might've seen in the second wave, an op-ed that got published in the Toronto Star calling attention to the fact that Doug Ford was using COVID as a way to kind of, you know, slime his way into doing a bunch of different things, basically disaster capitalism. So I have to say, it is always a question we should ask ourselves, can we do more? But I am, I hope you can feel assured that we are trying to do our best. And honestly, I would say, other unions are not. Other unions are getting pressed for things that are quite horrific in my view. People standing with the premier, for example. Not to derail a conversation, but I hear what you're saying. I want you to know we're doing our best, and any ideas you have would be great. The $10 a day childcare is a hugely important piece. It is something our social services sector is campaigning on with the Coalition for Better Childcare. Ontario is one of three provinces who hasn't signed a deal with the federal government to get money to provide a $10 a day not-for-profit childcare system in the province. Guess which three provinces? Ontario, Conservative. Alberta, Jason Kenney, crazy. He makes Doug Ford look good. And New Brunswick. The three places who have not signed on. So rest assured, we will be campaigning with the coalition, the childcare coalition, more on this and pressing for this $10 day childcare to come in. On the living wage front, it is something about which we have been talking. The last convention action plan actually called on us to demand a minimum wage of $20 an hour. It is an updated call from those who used to be part of what was used to be called 15 in fairness, right? So, you know, we want to do our best to start promoting the work of the Living Wage Network, which is quite an exciting network. You know, you can Google it, but it's got, you know, progressives and researchers and unions in it, but it also has employers in it. We often hear, oh, small businesses just can't take this minimum wage hike. While there's over 100 small business owners and operators who are part of the Living Wage Network who are advocating for living wages for workers, an important thing for us all to know and remember. I wanted to just, I saw that somebody was coming from a health coalition meeting, and I know Richard had asked about PSWs, and I wanted you to know that the work in our, particularly in long-term care, continues. We have been part of a national campaign, which, you know, has stalled a bit of late, but we will resume it to get profit out of care and long-term care. I'm proud to say that in working with the Ontario New Democratic Party, we have a in writing campaign promise that in their first term, if they are elected government, in their first term, they will end all for-profit long-term care in Ontario. That's a huge thing. A promise is good. In writing is better. But of course, we're going to need to do more than just rely on that. When we elect them, we're going to have to keep bolstering them and reminding them that they have a backbone, because the corporations are going to scream bloody frickin' murder, and we're going to have to scream double loud to make sure that we do what we need to do there. That includes this question of wages for PSWs. It has been incredibly divisive in long-term care, because PSWs have had an additional wage increase all the way along, while others who initially had pandemic pay did not. This again was a cynical attempt by the conservatives to pander to public opinion. Yes, PSWs deserve a wage increase. So do all workers who are working frontline in healthcare and in schools and in municipalities and social service agencies. The whole thing is just a craven attempt to, you know, pander to the public, but also divide our members. So these are things that our sectors are working on, working hard at, trying to, you know, talk internally with our members about, and also trying to figure out ways to get the message out externally. I'll just quickly say that we also today just launched a campaign on raising taxes in the province. This is something about which we've talked about for some time internally, but if you go to wealthtaxsimple, you'll see that we launched this campaign today. It calls on the government to raise taxes so that, you know, the growing inequality between the rich and the rest of us can actually start to be mitigated in some fashion. It's remarkable that we are paying part of the hydro bills for Loblaws because they introduced a subsidy. This is supposed to help during COVID for small business. Really, Amazon and Loblaws and Shoppers Drug Mart, we are paying part of their hydro bills while they're still paying people minimum wage and you know, paying the lowest corporate taxes they've paid in a generation and having massive profits to boot. So we're trying to, you know, talk it at all different angles, including this campaign we launched today.
We can, okay.
What about the issue of ivermectin, Fred?
Oh, you know, yeah, this, of course, there's a lot of misinformation out there and disinformation. Sadly, some of our members, like others in communities, have fallen prey to it. One of the things I should have mentioned is that we've been working to track where this information is coming from. And in fact, the Canadian Anti-Hate Network has discovered that every right-wing group, you know, think of the ones you've heard of before, the Proud Boys, the neo-Nazi groups, all those groups that were being tracked in Canada, there were about 30 of them that the Canadian Anti-Hate Network was tracking before the pandemic. virtually all of them, all but one, have completely converted into only providing information either against vaccination or about phony ways of dealing with COVID, like this misinformation about this ivermectin stuff.
This one's coming from a federal MP, a conservative MP.
Oh, yeah. The conservatives are part of these networks with these neo-Nazis and others who, by the way, don't give a good goddamn story. They don't really care about this stuff. What they're trying to do is get people into their algorithms and donating money to them. And they'll come back at them with Islamophobic stuff. They'll come back at them with anti-immigrant stuff. They'll come back at them with transphobic and homophobic stuff, and against Indigenous people and against, they will do this absolutely because that's what they do, is ferment that kind of discord, which we're seeing now.
Right. So Fred, you're about to hear three or four of us talk about what's happening in our locals or what's not happening in support of retirees engaging in some of the things we've been talking about. So just in case someone grabs you by the collar and yanks you out of this meeting for some like smaller important thing, before we do that, I just want to thank you on behalf of all of us, the 41, the gang of 41, and say that to issue you an invitation as if you need it to our March 1st semi-annual retiree meeting of QP Ontario. And you're writing down the date right now, hooray. And Megan here is gonna make sure it's in your calendar. But really, we'd like to hear from you. We'll give you a report card on how you've done the last 6 months. We're holding it March 1st because we know that you and we are holding a convention and we all have something to say about that and we may have resolutions. So just heads up. And again, thank you. And I'm gonna, there's claps, Ed Thomas is clapping, maybe others. So Joanna's like really keen. And so is Henry. So yeah, really thanks on behalf of us. And here comes what you've been waiting for, which is a few examples of what's happening at locals. So I'm gonna call on Mike.
Stephen, just a couple things. I just want to check. Albert, your hand is up. And I also see that Jana wants to speak and is on a speaker's list.
Okay. So Albert and Janet, I'm going to come to you in this part of the agenda, if that's all right. if I miss you, remind me. I don't think I will. So
I did want to, if I could, just speak quickly to the getting the message out part of this story, just for a moment. And thanks for setting up these meetings. First time I participated as a retiree, retired about a year ago, but still active with the Health Coalition. And to the point about the long-term care piece, just wanted to say thanks to Fred for, and I'm sure he didn't need to be dissuaded from doing so, but for not doing the very outrageous thing that happened with a couple of the other provincial and national presidents, actually standing up with Ford, when these two people are actually very deeply connected to the Ontario Health Coalition, with some of their senior executives fully understanding, I'm sure, and probably not very pleased with what happened with them standing with the premier during very egregious time. And I know that there's a lot of people on this call today that are quite well apprised of what's happened in the long-term care sector. But it speaks to this whole idea too about talk about undermining progressive positions. When you actually do something like this, that he's going to be able to take and put into his campaigns in the next few months, showing that he has the support of union leadership. But beyond that, even just to point out that Ford is still distressingly high in the polls. And I think it speaks to a problem that even as with our effective social media campaigns, that we have to find ways of challenging mainstream narratives too. And the fact that we can be so marginalized so often, I mean, there are some very good investigative reports that break through into the mainstream, but the drone of the day-to-day propaganda, I think, is something that we have to think about ways to strategize to counter. And I mean, challenging those institutions themselves, like when the CBC fails to report on the important contents of a rally or that sort of thing, that we find ways to encourage our membership to challenge it. Because we have to democratize those mass means of communication if we're really going to make sure that we don't lose, let's just say, in 2022, just for one example, or on the environment, which is just now becoming more prominent in our broader discussions, even though experts have been warning us for 25, 30 years that we are coming into this crisis, and now we only have a decade left. If there was ever an example that we needed to point out that we're not getting the messages that we need to get out there the way they need to, surely that's it. How could we find ourselves with so little time to deal with this? Anyways, I want to thank you very much for giving me a minute.
Thanks. Thanks for doing that, Albert.
Thank you.
Just on the point of the climate
crisis. Very high COVID spread among school-aged children in Southern Health.
So I'm going to ask people again to mute themselves. Albert, you, among other things, and really important, you identified the climate crisis or climate extinction as an important thing that we need to be working on. Just to say that there is climate justice working group in QP Ontario, which I happen to sit on, but also one of the retirees on this call has done a lot of work in looking at policies of the Ford government around climate change or like lack of work. And so, you know, we can share that a bit as well. But I know you made like a whole bunch of really important points, so I want to thank you for that.
Thank you very much.
It's great you're on the call. I'm glad you retired, otherwise you wouldn't be here.
I've got more time to do good stuff like this now.
There you go.
Okay. Don't have to run back to work.
Okay, which is a good segue into what's happening in your local about in support of retirees. And, you know, I used to use the word entrapment of our retirees into activism, but I think encouragement is pretty good. Mike Dineen, 2316, is about to tell us a little bit of what you've been doing.
If I must. Okay. We're the Children's Day Society. Am I coming through okay? I don't know.
It's a bit, maybe okay? Take off your video, maybe your bandwidth, and then we'll hear you
okay.
A little better.
I'll try again.
Okay, go for it.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right, we'll give it a try. Okay, the most recent thing we did was in September, where we had sort of an educational workshop slash open forum slash whatever you want to call it, between retirees, those who are about to retire, those who are thinking about retiring. And essentially what we did is we talked about our retirements, how we were doing. So we talked about finances and how you know, we're budgeting ourselves and things like that, because certainly we're not making the same money. We're on a pension. We talked about benefits and where to purchase, how to purchase, things like that. When we left, like when we leave our employer, we end up not having those same benefits. We have to search out for ourselves. And what's going to be the best cost factor for what we need. So we shared that kind of thing with the future retirees. We also talked about one of the biggest things was, you know, our well-being, our physical well-being and our mental health well-being. We talked a lot about that. I think most of our time was talked about, you know, our mental health when we left work. You know, being children's aid, and we see a lot of things, as everybody does in their employ. But one of the things one person had said was that when she's out driving and goes into, you know, a certain pocket of the town, it's like these things trigger. This individual's been retired for a few years already, but they still have these sort of recurring PTSD, I think is what we called it, effects of having, you know, from the job. So one of the things that we talked about was asking our local to try to help us figure out a way that the former employer could support the retirees in the early part of our retirement through, you know, maybe continuing with the EAP, for example. Is there a way that that could be done? So our executive is going to be looking at that, have agreed to take it to labor management. And I don't know that it can go on bargaining, even though that's coming up now for my local. It's something that the executive and the retirees feel really strongly about. Being able to have some supports once we leave the job. And it wouldn't be, you know, we're not asking for a long-term kind of a commitment to that. We're asking for, you know, a few months, 6 months, at best a year of ongoing or some supports from the employer with regard to this. So that was part of our discussion when we met with the soon-to-be retirees, or those that are thinking of moving on, or however you want to phrase that. So, and then, you know, our physical well-being, you know, we can't do the same activities, and how do we go about doing something else that will keep us healthy and active? There were, I think about a dozen, so it was a small group, mm-hmm. a dozen people in on this first meeting. We anticipate more. We're going to look at having something in the new year again, and hopefully we expand on that. So,
Mike, can I ask you?
I guess the other thing is that we're going to be doing an outreach to all the bargaining unit members by sending out a letter saying, hey, we've got this great group for after you retire, and you know, sign on. You know, come to one of our meetings, hear what we have to say, participate or not, but join in on it. We're going to be doing, you know, just different outreach things like that. We're going to re-review the current bylaws, of which we are part of.
Mike,
I can't hear you. What?
Mike, can I just, can you just tell us what?
I lost you.
What your, can other people hear me? What's your?
Position? I can hear you,
Mike. I don't know what you said.
Okay, so if you can hear me, Mike,
your I freeze or I missed out on what Stephen just said?
Can you hear me, Mike?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mike.
So I'm going to answer the question that I'm asking. And I think, Amar, you're interested in this. In 2316, in Mike's local, they changed the bylaws so that a retiree would be elected by the retiring members and would sit on the executive with voice.
I think you're asking me what position I have. Yeah. Stephen, I'd go on, Megan.
So I'm just going to have you on it. That's one of the models. Like, it's the only model that we have so far, but it's amazing. Other locals are doing it a different way, but actually 2316, where Mike is from, changed their bylaws, got them approved, you know, took them to a meeting, and now there is a retiree rep on the-
Yeah, we have bylaws.
I'm just gonna keep moving. Mike, if that's all right. Sorry, mm-hmm. A bit of sound trouble. I'm gonna ask I'm gonna say from my local, and then I'm gonna ask whether quickly anyone has any news from their local on how things are working.
Stephen, I don't want you to go ahead quite yet because I see that Amar's hand is up.
All right, Amar.
Not for a little bit.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to have a question to Stephen, maybe, or anybody who's expert in this area. If we can invite to the locals board meeting for about an hour sometime, just to give a presentation and answer some of the questions with your background, what you have to kind of let us educate us a little bit on that. So we're going to have a bylaw committee up running soon. So we want to bring that that committee to the local. Thanks.
You know, I'd love to, and I would recommend that Mike and I come so that their experience on bylaws and incorporating retirees into the bylaws are presented, or you know, we can chat about them. So would that be all right, Amar?
Yeah. That would be great. Thank you. So we'll get in touch. I'll get in touch with you later, Stephen.
Okay. So
thank you.
Yeah, I'll be good with that.
So I'm going to move on, if that's all right, unless there's a hand.
I just want to say, I think, Mike, were you trying to say something and we just couldn't get the audio correctly?
Yeah, I'm just saying that, you know, I'd be happy to meet
you. Mike, it's not working. At least on my end, it's going in and out. So maybe you can just send us a message in chat.
Okay. So thanks, Mike. I'm going to move on. Any other news from a local? Like what's happening with retirees. I'll just say for my local actually elects at our annual general meeting. We're across the province. We only meet once a year. So at our union meeting, we elect a retiree representative of the local. That representative happens to be me and goes to our annual convention in QP Ontario and sits with other retirees in the retiree caucus, which is where we have both voice and vote. We sit with our delegations on the floor of convention and have voice at convention. So that's how my local is what it's been doing. I'll just say that I've been, you know, whining or encouraging my local to actually collect the names and emails of those retiring. And we haven't done it yet, just an admission. And it's partly because we're spread out across, we have employers like 35 of them across the province. So it's sort of challenging, and you know, we're facing a lot of like things. So I will keep working on that, but that's sort of, you know, what's happening in our local 1281. Not too much to brag about. Any other folks? 7575, I think, is in the room, which is Joanne. Would you like to tell us what you told me by email? Or maybe you've had to leave. Lydia, Susan, Christina, 7575. So what I heard is that Local 7575 has 100 members, something like that, on a retiree list. And so they're able to, like, they've accumulated that and they're able to communicate with the retirees. I'll also say that there's a local in Belleville, and I've talked to the president of that local, who says, we could not run our local if it weren't for retirees. Fred has heard this. We bring our retirees, there are not a lot of them that we're in contact, but the ones we're in contact with, we bring them in and we get them to help us. And we get them to advise us when we're in bargaining. We get them to help us organize the annual picnic. Like, we use, is what this president said. we use our retirees. Any other of you want to say something about what's happening in your local? And nothing is, that answer is okay too.
You've got a speakers list. So you've got Ed Thomas first and Bertha is second.
Great, Ed.
Yeah, I don't know. Can you hear me?
Yes.
You can?
Yeah. Perfect.
You know, yeah, just in my local, I attend all our membership meetings. We don't have an actual retirement committee, but they put out a newsletter called The Scoop, which comes out every 3 months, and they have a commentary section which is dedicated to me, so I can write anything I want. So I've written about, I don't know, 40 some odd articles from what's the union done for me, parliamentary procedures, the job of a steward, health and safety, the day of mourning, a number of different issues, climate change. And they also, just within the last couple of years, they did a web page dedicated to the history of the local. They, we had the Workers' Arts and Heritage Center do it for a tune of $86,000. And I was one of the main people involved in helping them get our history up.
Wow. Go ahead, Ed.
No, that's it. Sorry.
So I have a question and then I'll go to Bertha. Would you be willing to share some of those articles that you've written with the rest of us? And if so, I'll share your email address with everyone and we can ask.
Yeah, that's fine. Yep.
If you had a list of them, maybe I'm pushing it now, of the different articles, I'd be willing to send it out to, you know, the 41 of us.
Okay, shall do.
Okay, I mean, you know, if you can, no rush. But thank you for the report. It's amazing. Bertha. And then Jana. Bertha, you need to unmute and start again.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, hi everybody. My name is Bertha Dusen. I'm from Local 870 in Ottawa. And I retired in the month of July. And this is the first time that I hear about a retirement committee for the union. So how do I go about to see what my union has for the retirees? Because I don't think that we ever had anything. for the retirees.
Yeah.
And so I don't even know like about like some people you guys have bylaws and you got for the retirees and all that, but I don't think we have anything there. I've been there for 29 years. So
So we should have started with you because you're what you've just described is pretty much the same across. Fred, how many local unions do we have in the province?
Over 1,100.
So that's a lot. And you, like what you've described is what my local, you know, had done before I went and like, you know, spoke up and said, hey, we have to do something. And it's the case. So here's my advice, because I've had this question like a number of times. Mm-hmm. I'm really glad you asked it. So for me, what you could do is go talk to anyone you know on your executive, the president, okay, Stewart, and say, hey, I just went to this really cool meeting. And how about if a couple of us retirees get together and talk about what we can do for the union?
Okay.
And, you know, if you could ask that Stewart to take this to, you know, the next membership meeting, or you could go to the membership meeting.
I don't think I'm allowed. They're not letting retirees to the meeting.
Okay.
I'm not allowed no more.
Okay, there you go. So this is not uncommon either. So if you talk to one person
who
goes to those meetings and is on the executive, then you could like share your proposal, which is to have retirees do something in your local and support your local. And you could even say, you know, there are various things I heard about in QP Ontario of what people are doing in different locals. I did say to someone, after you've done that, the second step is see if there's any interest from an executive member or a steward to move a motion that we create a small committee of retirees, or that B, we collect contact information of retirees as they leave the workplace, as they, you know, as people in the workplace. So those are two things that you could do just to get things going. I'll just say that under QP Ontario bylaws, we as retirees have voice, but no vote.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'd be happy to talk to your president or anyone to let them know that, you know, we're all in QP Ontario and this is what QP Ontario does, and maybe cajole them in, you know, allowing you at meetings. But in the meantime, yeah, talk to a steward and see if you can get things rolling. You can say there's, you know, all the things you heard today.
Yeah, yeah. And I was always involved with the union. Always, always, always. I'm for it. I did everything in my power. I go every meeting and all that. But definitely, I will take your advice and I'll go to the local and I'll do my best to be able to get what I can get to be. And like today, I have nothing in front of me. I have, you know, there's nothing. They just, they signed me up and that was it. So I don't mind going, but I'd like to have some stuff in front of me, you know?
So the fact they signed you up for this meeting
is
your opening.
Okay.
Like, you can say, I want to report back on this meeting. Like,
I will.
Choice now but to listen to you, and I'm sure you can do it. Can I ask you something? Would you be willing to just let me know like in the next month what happened?
Yes, I will, for sure. Yep. I will get on this as soon as I can. Absolutely.
Terrific. I'm going to go, if that's all right. Thank you, because this is a really good case study. Joanna. And then Vern.
Okay, so I was just curious. You said that you talked to 907 in Belleville?
Yeah.
Was that correct?
I've been a member of that union for 43 years, and I've never heard of anything going on at there for the retirees.
So I think you're not an education worker, are you? I think it was the education workers local, which would be a different local from yours. So, it, you know, people working in the schools are teaching members, and I think it was that local, actually.
Okay, yeah, because we're city workers, and when you retire, you're gone. And there's no communication, there's nothing.
It's the same here. Same here.
Yeah.
So I'd give you the same advice and ask you how it goes. You know, talk to one member that you know, or, you know, coordinate a steward, let everyone know, see what you can do. And let the rest of us know, or let me know, and I'm happy to talk to anyone in your local and say, this is a thing in Kipi.
Okay.
Okay, I will try.
Great, that's wonderful. I have Megan with her hand up, but I had someone else.
It's you've got Susan Gapka in front of me.
Okay, Susan, you're on. And I think you were also going to mention a constitutional amendment that QP Ontario put in to the QP National Convention happening next week, right?
I thought you were going to mention that. But I was trying to help here, Stephen. I'm also wanted to make sure we introduced or recognized Martine Stonehouse, who is here, who I think has the same challenges. And I think Megan, I was just like thinking of a way, everybody who registered for this meeting, we will have their email address. And so we could ensure that people are getting notices because and so that they can talk to their union when they see if they're local or even just register without their local. But I have been thank you. I see Bertha nodding there. So thank you. Yeah, just trying to help get people connected as I am with Martine is just to say is a retiree who's registers every time I send her the notice, but I will make sure that Megan has your email after Martine and just so that we can make sure that you get the notices. I've posted a couple of things in the chat around vaccination policies to help people around those questions. That's one thing I can do to be helpful in the background, like almost becoming like learned about some of the policies of QP. But I also want to invite you to our human rights conference. And I think people can register. And I'm going to check with you, Megan, on that. But our human rights conference, racial justice, human rights and women's virtual conference from December 7th to 10th. And if I recall, that is open to retirees. We just have to figure out how to get people registered. And so I just want to do, I'm as one of the human rights committee members, that's really important to me. And that comes right after national. So I'm just trying to help now. I don't know. Maybe we can go over to Megan. Stephen, you can come back to me. I'm not familiar with the retirees constitutional amendment, but I was hoping you could fill us in on that. And then I could lead into the couple other things I was thinking about.
Okay.
Thank you for letting me share. Oh yes, one last thing about Martine. She was a runner up for the Solidarity and Pride Award at last week's Ontario Federation of Labour Convention. I didn't tell her till Monday that I had nominated her, but I also wanted to acknowledge that Stephen Seaborn actually wrote a letter of support, as did QP 4400. So just thought we've got a bit of a star in our midst here with Martine, you know, and Fred and all of you fabulous people.
Thank you, Martine, welcome. It's great to see you. I'm going to go to Megan because we want to ask her about some publicity work that needs to be done. And I know Philip Morgan, you'll see on our screen, has a request of each of us.
Yeah. Stephen, I just wanted to say Philip, for being so patient with us as we make our way through. Experiencing the kind of audio distortions that I'm experiencing here, but I hear people very clearly, and then other times it goes in and out. So I've turned off my camera, hoping that it's a problem on my end, but I'm not. So I just wanted to let you know that. So, Susan, I think you were asking me specific questions about the at all, but can I ask you a favor? Can you just follow up with me after the call so that I'm clear about that and I can get the answers to the questions that you're asking, and we can share that back out with people if needed? And Bertha, I wanted to actually specifically ask to be assigned to this group of the retirees, because I used to watch really strong activists leave locals, and they would just, their locals just really didn't invite. Drove me a little bit crazy, to be honest with you, because I thought these are the people that and are really passionate about the kind of work that they've been involved in. Seemed very wasteful to me. So you're in very good company with all the other folks that are on the. I just wanted to ask you what local you're with. Maybe just put it in the chat for me afterwards. So
I'm local 870. I was at the Pearly Rideau Veterans Health Center. Now it's called the Pearly Health.
You know, I'm still.
So what city?
Just put it.
Ottawa.
Yep.
Thing is that if Stephen's got it, because I want to make sure that we can, if there's. Assist you to provide you with the information you need. And Bertha, just so you know, we started with like just a handful of people, and every time we have one of these meetings on a hill, it just keeps gathering more and more people, which is to have you here today.
Oh, thank you. I'm happy too.
Okay.
And Bertha is in local 870. I have it
870.
On.
Thank you.
So I'm Megan, thank you for
before you go to Philip, if you can just don't mind being patient for just
okay.
Very patiently waiting with his hands up for a while now.
So we're gonna go to Philip, but I just want to, on behalf of all of us and myself, Megan, I want to thank you for volunteering, for asking to be the staff support of this really important network. And okay, there's a lot of applause for you, and rightfully so. So thank you. Philip, welcome to the meeting. Maybe you could just say who you are and what you want from us.
So I think Megan was trying to go to Vern first, because Vern's been waiting to speak.
Sorry, good call. Vern, go ahead.
Hello, everyone. I'll be retired 3 years the end of this month. The first year that I was retired, my local brought me back to run the strike committee for the school board, which was great. Unfortunately, COVID hit and there hasn't been a whole lot we can do. But what I was gonna ask was, would it be possible for people to send out examples of good bylaw language that I can bring forward?
I can do that. I've got the really good language from Mike from 2316, and it's like the gold standard. I will send it to all of us on the list.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Lots of thumbs up. Henry's keen. So on to you, Philip. Thanks for waiting, really. If I were you, I would have cycled around the block, but there you go.
I guess I should introduce who Philip.
Go ahead.
Philip Morgan actually works with us at QP Ontario, and he does our communication support. So what the heck does communication? It's like all of the social media. So he's managing, works directly with our communication staff and our campaigns folks. He's getting the word out to all of as many QP members as possible. Now, Philip, we wanted Philip to come on the call today because we, as you guys have probably heard Stephen and I talk about in the past, pictures of our retirees folks and all of the important and going out there in your communities. So we wanted to bring that and how we can find get some of those photos of you. To hear more about what Philip does and how you might be able to engage the actions that we have going on at QP Ontario.
Great. That kind of- Philip, that's your introduction. Thanks, Megan. Go for it.
Hey. Well, first of all, thanks for having me. It's nice to meet all of you, even if it is virtually. So as Megan mentioned, I do communications at QP Ontario. So I do a bunch of the social media. And what I've found in the last few months that I've been in the role is that there's a real dearth of images when it comes to retirees. So you're not represented as much as I would like, and I think as the organization, as the union would like, for how active you folks are in the union. So we need to get more photos of you. So if you have photos of yourself on your phone or on your computers, please feel free to send them to me. My email address is pmorgan, so P as in Philip, M-O-R-G-A-N, at qp.on.ca. And you can just send me the photos that way. But also, you know, if you ever have any questions, if you're, you know, if you're wondering, if there's anything you're wondering about communications, about social media, you can just reach out to me if you have any questions. I'm always happy to promote things that you're doing, because again, I know so many of you are very active. So yeah, that would be the big thing. And what I would say is, if you end up, if you're at events, or if you're, you know, even if you're at home and you're taking a photo of yourself to send to me, the one thing I would say is make sure that your lens is clean. I know it sounds like a really small thing, but it does help with the quality of the photo. And so if you just kind of wipe it off with your shirt, you know, as you would like an apple or something like that, and just wipe the lens off, it really improves the quality of the photo. And so I'm going to share screens with you for a moment just to show you an example of some of the stuff that I do. So let me just show you here. So don't know if everybody can, hopefully you can see that. It's just a graphic that I made for a rally that was happening in Wellesley Township in at the end of October. And really the thing I want to draw your attention to is this gentleman here in the bottom of this box over here. So that was a photo that was taken at a rally. It's not a stock image, although I do sometimes use stock images, but that's an actual member who was at a rally. And so with a high quality photo, I was able to just clip out the background and just put it on a flyer. And you know, that's just one small example of someone getting involved and being part of, you know, being part of the of QP's message that goes out into the world. So I would love to have your faces on flyers if you're open to that. I would love to be able to, you know, clip an image of you and put it with a really powerful graphic or statement or flyer, whatever it may be. So again, if you find photos of yourself or, you know, photos of yourself or others at events, please feel free to send them to me. And stop sharing screen. The one other thing I wanted to draw your attention to is that next week there's going to be some emails about solidarity with New Brunswick. So as many of you know, QP members in New Brunswick are currently on strike. There's 22,000 of them that are on strike. The conservative government under Premier Higgs is refusing to negotiate. They've offered wage increases that are below the rate of inflation. So effectively people will be falling further and further behind each year. And so New Brunswick workers have said enough is enough and they're on strike. I believe today is either day 10 or 11 of that strike, and it doesn't, there's no sign of things really improving. So next week they're going to be some, an email going out talking about what you can do in solidarity. One of the things is going to be to hold a little sign that will say, you know, solidarity with New Brunswick, or we're still working on what the text will look like, but I would love to have photos of you folks that I can share on Instagram and on Twitter and of all of our platforms of you folks in solidarity with workers in New Brunswick. So I just want to put that on your radar. It'll be coming out early next week. And those are just some of the ways that you can support me in the comms role. Do any of you have any questions or anything like that? I know I ran through things pretty quickly. But
no, that was great. Philip. So questions? Albert.
Just a quick remark about solidarity with New Brunswick. I know that a bunch of troublemakers in Ottawa the other day had staged a rally outside of the hospital linen services facility, and there might be some video around about that. So apparently the government of New Brunswick has saw fit to send their dirty laundry to Ontario since they couldn't get it cleaned in New Brunswick, I guess, with the folks being locked out, so their claim was. So some people took up the task to call them out on that a couple of days ago. So there was some video on Facebook that I saw. I think Joel Harden had posted some stuff.
Great. So Albert, that's an example where if you had been at that rally, like it's good, the video is great, but if you had been at that event and got and handed your phone to someone else and, you know, showed the world that the retirees are right there.
Yeah, for sure. I should mention that I'm in Northern Ontario now. I moved up to Blind River, Ontario. So willing to lend a hand with things that are happening up this way. If anybody wants to flag something for me at some point along the way, I stay active with the folks in Ottawa when I can, but I have moved to Blind River. So, yeah.
I know Blind River well. That's great. So I'm sure we can paste your face in somehow to a rally in Ottawa. And people will recognize you because that's where you were active as a union member.
That's right.
It's a good example, like as things open up and more of us are able to like get out with our masks, that would help, right, Philip?
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, what I've seen, particularly on Instagram, is there's a real thirst for pictures of people. You know, as much as I can sort of create graphics and do banners and things like that, by and large, audience members respond to seeing pictures of actual human beings out there in the world doing things. So just, you know, a simple picture of yourself goes a very long way.
And I thought Instagram was just about what you had for dinner, wasn't it? No, I agree with you totally. Any other questions for Philip?
I see that Jana's hand is up.
Okay, so it's not really a question for Philip, but everybody's leaving and my hand got forgotten when we were on topic a little bit a while ago. That's okay. I'm administrator for the COVID Long Hauler Support Group Canada. I don't know if anybody has heard of our group. We represent over 14,000 people that have been affected by COVID. You see media on TV about the long haulers. They're coming from our group. There's studies and clinics that are being developed all across Canada, and they're being developed because the head of our group, Susie Golding, is on media all the time. And I know that we talk about health and mental health. The long haulers have been affected so badly by COVID. And I've posted a few things in some of the things to do with QP, but it's awful. My daughter got it in March 2020, and she still can work 1 4-hour shift a week, maybe. So it's something that doesn't get touched on by QP that I know of. And that is a severe mental health issue as well as a physical health issue. And so I just wanted to put out there. So it's COVID Long Hauler Support Group Canada. And we have provincial groups as well. So people can get information from each of the different social. So there's an Ontario group. So if there's people looking for doctors or looking for studies, they can go there. We started one for the Indigenous. There's one for Northern Canada, and there's one for each of the provinces. So it's something that if you haven't joined and you're interested in what COVID has done, and when ivermectin got mentioned earlier, I was just horrified because there's no, maybe a few Americans that are on our group may have tried to use ivermectin. It gets talked about in our group and we try not to encourage it because it's for horse parasites. And it has helped nobody that we know of. Right. So anyway, that's my soapbox.
Okay. Thank you for that. If you can send a little description or a clip or an email, a website address, I'll get it out to the rest of the group.
I see that Philip took a note of that too, right? So we're always looking for good resources. We're all about just educating our members about what good resources and, you know, science-based resources that we can share with people. Now, just to address something else that you said, Fred didn't really say it when he was on the call, I don't think earlier, but we have at QP Ontario been doing a lot of town hall calls just to provide a good quality information to our members in the hopes that we can combat some of this, you know, misinformation that's out there. And as soon as you sent that out, actually that link, there's one of our staff people, Wynn Hartfitson in our office, is actually following some of those pieces of information and figuring out what the source of that is and figuring out, you know, how do we inoculate our members against this kind of information. So I did share that with her, that link, as soon as you put it up, just to let you know that there was some action on that. Now I just need to borrow you all for just one second here, because Philip has been working really hard to incorporate he's committed to working really hard to get our retirees out there. And I just need you all to show us with a show of hands or put up the little marker hand, whatever, to say who knows they have photos on their phone right now where you're engaged in rallies or other activities. Okay. Did you guys write down Philip's email address?
Yes.
Joanne, I know you've got good photos. I can't hear her because she's muted.
We'll send
it. I read your
list. One more time for address.
One more time, yeah.
Okay.
So it's P Morgan. So PMORGAN at qp.on.ca.
I need your guys' commitment to send Philip those photos because we need them really badly. The other thing I need to know is that Philip is trying to kind of put, we're putting together a list of just other social media accounts that he could be just checking on every day or every couple of days to see, just to follow people and get a sense of like other activities that he could help with amplifying out there. Is there anybody on this call today who is really active on social media? Henry Evans Turnbrinkle.
Tenbrinkle,
thank you.
Noel, just Tenbrink.
Tenbrink. Oh, sorry, Tenbrink. I need glasses, apparently. Tenbrink. Steven,
okay, who else?
Doug, did you have your hand up?
Yes.
Okay. Albert Dupuis, D-U-P-U-I-S. Anna, did you have your hand up? No? She's like, no, not me. Okay. Did I miss anybody? Because I really want to make sure we capture all of you.
Joanne is now on Facebook. Like, once you're on Facebook.
Susan had her hand up. No.
Susan? Where are you, Susan? You're not on my screen, this first screen.
I know who's on Facebook.
Okay.
It wasn't me, but I did take a screenshot a little earlier. I just have, and then I found all the ones I took last week that I couldn't find on. So I'll send that to you, Megan. I didn't ask your permission, but I took a screenshot of us here.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
I better figure out how to like find it in my files and send it to you. I'm trying to copy it, but I can't. So yeah, I see Brian smiling with me. I'm trying to help here.
I have one more question for you. So this action that's going to happen next week, is it something we download, Philip, and then we have to actually print it and do it, or can people just write up their own signs?
Yeah, to be determined. I mean, I envision it being something that will be printed, but also if folks don't have a printer, which many people don't, then you can just write it out and hold it up.
Okay, so if everybody can commit to doing that next week, that would be great too. I want to showcase our retirees. I want you guys to be the stars, right?
Yeah, Philip, Henry Evans-Stenberg here, QP retiree from Local 7800, and I'm a delegate to Hamilton District, retiree delegate to Hamilton District Labor Council. And I'm also a recording secretary for the Congress of Union Retirees of Canada for Hamilton, Burlington, Oakville. Just wanted to let you know, I have hundreds of pictures of retirees in action. Photography is one of my hobbies. And so whenever there's an action, I go out and take photos if I can.
Okay. Enhance us down.
Okay, you are now the star. Like you win the prize. Like you, like this is so good.
For all of the folks that mentioned that they have photos, so please send them to me at the email address that I mentioned. And then once I have your contact information, if you have hundreds of photos like Henry, we can figure out the best way to get those photos to me, because I would love to see them. So let's establish contact and then we can figure out next steps for sure.
And Philip, I will I'll send this message to the gang of 41 who registered on this call, that with your email, and maybe you and I can work on the message for that, but we'll request those photos from everyone. I want everyone to smile right now. You have a minute to smile. I'm taking a screenshot. So this is the remnants. Smile, Bavori, I want to see you smile. Okay, there's the screenshot. I'll send it to you. I'll send it around. I'll send it to you, Philip, as well.
Stephen, just quickly before, just in case Jana has to leave. Jana, I sent you, in the chat, the link to that petition regarding the ivermectin.
Okay.
I could not believe it. It's being sponsored by a federal conservative MP.
And Henry, if you want to send it to me, I can send it to Jana's email, just to be sure, because once we close, the chat's gone forever. There's a phrase that I use when you go over by half an hour in a meeting, and it's sort of like false promises. The meeting was supposed to end half an hour ago, and here we are. So my apologies for that, but as we, I'll just take one more minute to say that the QP and Ontario Convention, get out your calendars and give you the date, is April 27th to 29th.
Is it virtual?
No, it's going to be in person. You can get your local to send you.
Henry and I are going to have to arm wrestle.
I know who's going to win.
I'll just find a turtle and put it in front of her and I'll win. Okay. It always reminds her of our trip to Sault Ste. Marie, and she laughs so hard she won't be able to win.
I'll be pestering all of you to try and get your local to convention. This year, like the past years, there's no actual registration cost. So, you know, like if you can help you with food, transport, accommodation, that's great. But if you're outside of Toronto, you might have to like get a ride with someone, bring a sandwich, stay with a relative, like there's all kinds of, but I would hope that some of us can be there. I hope all of us can be there.
You gotta call me back from on the phone.
Yeah, okay. So I just want to thank everyone remaining. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. 16 of us who held out to the bitter end, and say that I'll be talking to you about helping you be a delegate to convention. But a month before, actually almost 2 months, we'll have our meeting on March 1st. Bring to that meeting your suggestions for resolutions to go forward to convention. So there's the notice, I'll be giving you more. I want to thank Megan for all the work she does in supporting this retirees network, because honestly, Megan.
Oh, I love you guys, you know that. But I feel like we've forgotten something, Stephen.
I'm sure I jumped over the agenda.
I feel like it had to do with the wording in the Constitution about like being sent from locals. What was that again?
So the wording, there are two things. One, the national Constitution doesn't recognize us as people. You know how women were finally recognized as people. And
oh, Stephen.
we are not recognized in the same way that QP Ontario, you know, recognizes us and gives us a voice but no vote. So that's the constitutional amendment that I sent to the QP Ontario Executive Board, spoke to at the board, and QP Ontario sent it off to QP National, which is next week, right? So if you have contact, if any of us have contact with our president or anyone from our local going to the national convention, please just give them the heads up and do what I'm doing, which is you have to go to the mic. Like, you have to go and speak for this resolution, because then we would be able to have some retiree voice at our national union and all the other parts of the country as well. So that's one. Susan, did you have another?
Okay, just a second. I wasn't on mute. I was looking that up because I thought we were going to skip it, but Megan, yeah. So there is, I have some good news. I'm QP Ontario. I think it's good news. I am QP Ontario's constitution, national convention constitutional member, which means I will be advocating for both the retirees motion and the other constitutional amendments that can't talk today. the constitutional amendments. So there's the retirees. So I was just looking that up when you brought it up, but I imagine it's very similar. So you have me to advocate on our behalf for that. There is a diversity. I'm looking at my background there. There's a diversity vice president's constitutional amendment, which has been defeated the last 3 or 4 national conventions. So QP Ontario put forward one, which I am required to advocate for with, you know, directions from our president who was on here. He can be quite compelling. that we saw the equity, because right now there's 2 diversity vice presidents, Indigenous and racialized workers. And we think that Pink Triangle and workers with disabilities, women, and at Ontario, we actually went one step further than what the working group decided, was to add a 4th one for young workers. Not everybody across the country agrees with that. So it's much like if you're familiar with the Ontario Constitution, as that happens, that gives the benefit of someone like myself, as when the Constitution was amended to have a retirees network representative. So it's about ever expanding who's represented. There's a saying, which I learned at Senate, with the trans rights legislation. If you're not at the table, you're likely on the menu, and that's a bit of
Ooh.
A you like that, Joanne? If you're not
yes,
at the
I
table,
do.
You're likely on the menu, and you like that. Thanks. So anyways, I will be advocating for that. And if any of you are, I don't know how many of you are for. So I mean, yeah. So that's the other thing. Did you want me to quickly go through the two other items?
The endorsement?
Is that yeah, it? I'm not sure what the procedure is. I'm looking to you, Megan, but had we be on earlier, but our secretary treasurer, which you will know very well, who's worked with Fred for so many years.
What's her name again?
Candace Rennick. And Candace Rennick is running for national secretary treasurer and was wondering if we'd like to endorse her and to give her that final momentum going into convention next week. We all think she's pretty terrific, but not to force you into a position. So I'm going to turn that suggestion over to the chair. But the other thing that is, if she
just before you do that, Susan, I'll take that as a motion. Is there a seconder?
I'll second.
Okay. Discussion on the motion.
Candace is terrific. And really good and really experienced at her job.
Okay, good.
Can I ask who's waiting in the background in Ontario?
No, let's vote on the motion first. And then
it's not me. It's not me. Wait, so, there's a motion on the floor, Chair.
There is, and discussion has ended. I hear all those in favor.
I'm against, but I'm voting every chance I get.
Okay. It's carried, and we'll communicate that. And your second motion is?
Since Candace is, I'm not doing it correctly, procedure. Okay, the motion is to endorse Yolanda McLean as general vice president. And I see Joanne's seconding it.
Yes, I am.
And as Candace now holds that position, is not going to be having their name put forward for it. Of course, you know, QP Ontario Executive Board, you may not know, we have endorsed Candace Rennick, of course, but we've also endorsed and are hoping that Yolanda McLean fills that position. So I'd like to ask you if you agree or agree with that. And so over to you, Chair. There's a motion on the floor and it's been vigorously seconded by Joanne Webb.
Thank you. Discussion motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? I think there's none. It's unanimously carried and will be delivered.
That was really nice that we did that.
Thank you. Thanks for bringing it forward, Susan. That's really helpful.
It was worth staying around for.
There you go. So having said that, Joanne had the first word and that's the last word. I want to thank you all for being here and let you know that I will be sending an email with the link to the entire proceedings this afternoon. Which have been taped. So that'll be it, but a few follow-ups as well. Please let me know if you're tired of my email and I will take you off the list. And I won't hate you for that, just saying. Okay.
Hey, Matt, yes. Before you go, I sent you in the chat a copy of a resolution that I put forward to Labor Council that was passed with a good majority regarding the AUKUS, and I'd like your opinion on it. And it's one of the resolutions I'd like to see QP support.
Can you send that to me by email and then?
Okay, I'll do that.
Okay, thanks. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much. I'll see you all, if not before, on March 1st.
Stay safe, everybody.
Bye, everyone.
Thanks, bye.
See you next time.
Later.
Thank you. Good night, John boy.
Bye-bye.
Bye, guys.
Megan, are you?
Be safe, everyone.
For you. Bye, Joanne.
Merry Christmas.
I guess, right?
Happy anyway, Monica. Megan, I'll make sure Phillips gets some of those pictures.
I'm so glad you will. Thank you very much, Henry.
Bye, Martine.
Bye.
When all of you leave.